I recently bought a new keyboard from Logitech, which has a stupid problem that actually people have been complaining about for years since the previous version of this keyboard. It's the Logitech G915X, and it's actually a pretty decent one, I like it, except for one thing. It has no numlock indicator of any kind. So of course I had to go and fix it myself, which I'll get to. Now, I never turn off numlock. I want to be able to use the number pad, and a lot of people are the same way, but sometimes it automatically or accidentally gets activated, and then it causes frustration when you can't figure out why the numpad isn't working, and then you just have to assume that, oh, I guess it's on, you have to press the button. For example, in Windows, the Hyper-V virtual machines, for some godforsaken reason, all by default, disable numlock when you boot them up every time. But like I said, there have been people asking since the original G915 keyboard years ago for some kind of indicator, like when you press the key or if it's on, just use the lighting built into the keyboard to change the light of the numlock key in the firmware. It's pretty standard. I've seen lots of keyboards that have this feature and people have been requesting it. You'd think that one, they would either at least add a standard numlock light. The wired version of the keyboard has one, a numlock, but with the wireless one that I got, it replaced the numlock light with the battery light. So there's no numlock of any kind. Anyway, Logitech definitely saw it because one of the employees responded to a couple of those threads saying that he would make the suggestion to the team, and even though they had the opportunity to fix it in this new version, they never did. Anyway, I did what I usually do and pulled a fine, I'll do it myself, and made an app that uses the Windows API, the new Windows 11 Dynamic Lighting API that actually can natively control a lot of devices that support it, including, fortunately, Logitech devices. And it lets you set the on-off colors for not just the numlock, but also the caps lock and scroll lock keys, so that, look at this, when you press on and off, look, it changes the color. It's like magic. And yes, it does actually check the real status of the key. It doesn't just toggle dumbly. Plus, it has some other neat features that I knew I would use, like being able to control it via local URL commands like this. So you can even control it through like the command prompt in a script or something like that. Now, to be clear, I would still very much like it if Logitech made a first-party solution for this built into the hardware of the device itself. I shouldn't have to have a background running task all the time for this. What I would really like is it built into the firmware where there's an optional setting so that if you enable this feature, then it would just override whatever lighting effect is going on and just use the status color for those three keys. Now, I have seen that other people made similar purpose tools in the past. However, the ones that I saw at least had some problems. First of all, they all relied on polling, which means that they basically had a thread going that would every set amount of milliseconds check the status of the key, which is not really that efficient to just have a while loop going. I don't like that. And also, all the ones that I saw all required having an additional third-party program running in the background. So not just that app, but then another one, whether it's the Logitech G Hub software, even if it was using the Logitech G SDK to interact directly with the keyboard, you still apparently, based on my experience, have that G Hub software open, or another one used like open RGB, but again, that still had to be running. I didn't want anything extra. And even on top of that, the Logitech SDK one, apparently that overrides any lighting that you want to do in the G Hub software for all your devices. You can't just do it on the one keyboard, so not ideal. However, my app is structured a little bit differently. It does not use polling. Instead, it uses the Windows raw input API to get a signal, basically, anytime a key is actually entered in the keyboard, and then it checks if it's one of those keys. It's not ideal. There's no way in Windows to get a signal if a specific key is pressed. You can do it with hotkeys, but then it like stops that key from actually working, and then you have to like relay the key using a virtual input, which can mess things up. I wasn't going to get into that. This doesn't add much overhead since the Windows system is already processing every key behind the scenes. It just adds your app to the list of Windows that gets the notification. And like I said, it does not require the Logitech G Hub software to be running for it to work. It uses the Windows API. But again, it seems like you do have to at least have the G Hub software installed because it has like drivers. All right, so why don't we go over to the computer and I'll show you more details about the features. It's actually pretty simple. There's not a lot to it. It's just like one settings thing, but there's some neat stuff that I want to point out. All right, so here it is. Here's the app. It's just one settings window, and it runs in the background. So if you close it out, it'll just have the system tray icon. This is what it looks like. You just click it to bring it up. There's also a little context menu. You can restart it or exit from down there. Now, to actually download and install it on the GitHub page, which I'll link in the description, you go under releases and it'll show you the most recent version, and then look under assets, and then the MSIX is the file. It's like an exe, but it's like a package thing in Windows. It's like a more newer thing. Anyway, that's it right there. Anyway, when you bring it up, this is what it looks like, and the first thing you want to do is click enable, and this will enumerate the devices or just look for the different available devices. And in this case, these are just like mice, and this is the keyboard. So then you do that, and you can also stop it if you wanted. I'm going to hit apply after you select the one you want. And notice that the first time you do this, you're actually going to have to go into the settings in Windows and allow it to run in the background. So basically, it'll show some instructions here if you want to expand it. But you just go into the dynamic lighting, and then here you want to find at the top the device that you want to use this on. Don't do this in this main menu. This will apply to everything. Just go to this specific device and then look for background light control and dynamic lighting key indicator, and just drag this to the top. And this basically is telling Windows, let this app here control the lighting while it's in the background for this device. Otherwise, it won't work. And then it'll say status good. It'll automatically detect that it's working. And at this point, it now is able to change the color on the keyboard, or at least should if your device works with it. Anyway, in terms of actually controlling the color, so the default option is going to be what like the whole regular keyboard key is. So you can actually just do that and it'll in real time update on your keyboard, or you can just use the defaults, which is like this blue, and then you can set the individual on and off state color. So if caps lock is on, for example, it will be red, and otherwise it'll be the off color, and you can customize all these. The link icon means that you synced it to the default color down here, and it'll show a little link icon when that's the case, and then you'll notice that they all update along with that when you change it. If you change it individually, it'll no longer show it with the link, and you can bring it back with that button. And then also the outline, it's kind of hard to see with certain colors, but here it's easier. When you toggle it, it'll actually show the active state. So you can see if it's like showing the correct color that it should be. And by the way, there is a dark mode for this. It automatically changes based on your system settings. I might add a toggle button or something to manually do it. Now you can also press these buttons to swap the ones easily if you just want to try it out. Like for example, in most cases, I probably want to have the on state, which is the one where the number keys work, then I want that to be like normal and only show red if the number keys are not working. So that means numlock is off. That's why you can customize the on and off state for both of them. And then you can also control the global brightness to adjust all of them at once. And then you can also undo, and that'll bring it back to the last saved state. So if you want to kind of play around with it, you can do that, and it'll just stay like this until you either save or restart the app. And then if you save the color settings, then it will use that when you restart the app as well. So basically, default just goes to this with the red and blue. Undo will go to the last saved state, and then save saves it to like the file so it can store it. And also, when you restart, it will automatically try to reconnect to the last device you applied it to. So you can have it start up with Windows. You don't have to configure it every time and select the device. And you can select that right here to start with Windows. It'll automatically register. And then also you can probably want to do it start to minimize the tray so it doesn't open the window every time. And then you'll see it in the icon. And then there's this advanced info, which I just kind of added as an extra. It shows if the keyboard device is available, connected, and enabled. The available one is basically whether or not you have the background lighting control set to allow it. If it's at the bottom, then that's when available will say false, and then it'll give you the warning up there. Connected and enabled, I think it's literally if it's physically connected and enabled, I'm not really sure. And then the open config folder, that just opens up
right here, the automatic settings folder thing that Windows uses for packages. And then you can open up the JSON file and see how it's all configured, or maybe for some reason it bugs out, you need to delete the config, you can just do it through that. Other stuff, the lighting menu, this simply takes you to this menu. Now, finally, some advanced stuff, like I talk about in the GitHub page under URL protocol control. If you want to control the app through like a script or something like that, you can actually use commands like these. So I have an example with command prompt and PowerShell. There's a associated URL protocol that it registers with Windows. It doesn't actually connect to the internet. It's like a local thing. And for example, say you want to change the brightness via command, you could do something like this. So if I put that in here and then maybe set it to 50%, like at night, maybe I'll have a script run at night and I hit enter and you can see, boom, it went down and it won't save the settings. I might add like another command to save it, but right now it's like temporary. And that way you can have your saved settings and then change it when you need to temporarily with the commands. And then there's several other parameters you can use. So you can set the default color and then all the individual keys if you want and multiple at the same time, that sort of thing. And yeah, I think that pretty much covers it.
All right, so hopefully you guys found this app pretty cool. Like I said, it's pretty simple. And I actually want to keep it that way, keep it pretty simple. So please don't make any big pull requests with like lighting effects and stuff. I was already forced to use the newer Windows SDK and do XAML instead of Windows Forms, which I'm familiar with because the API requires that you use packaged apps. So it's already kind of a mess with a lot of jankiness behind the scenes. So if you want to add features yourself, go ahead, but don't expect me to like do any pull request reviews or anything. I just might not look at it. If you enjoyed the video, be sure to give it a big giant thumbs up for the YouTube algorithm. And if you want to keep watching, the next video I'd recommend is where I talked about how 32-bit programs sometimes might actually be faster than 64-bit programs. If you didn't know that about that before, I could put that link right there you can click on. So thanks so much for watching and I'll see you in the next one.